Hey, everybody. Well, talk about a tease. You know, the folks at the Vans Aircraft are usually pretty tight-lipped, but they've just put out a couple of YouTube videos to give you all a taste of their latest kit, the RV15. Now, Vans told us, I guess it was about a year ago, that the RV15 was coming, but not a lot more. And what will surprise a lot of RV watchers is that this kit will be a high wing with beefy conventional gear that looks like it would be really quite comfy in the backcountry. And Vans is touting that the shock absorbers for this gear will be inside the fuselage. Now, we have a guy on staff who's pretty much an RV expert. He's owned several and is currently flying one, and that would be Dave Hirschman. He examined the video and has figured a bit more about the prototype. He thinks it's most likely a Lycoming IO390 pumping about 210 horsepower there. The constant cord wing will simplify construction, as will the slab side fuselage, and it will likely be the simplest Vans kit yet to build. Now, Vans will be exhibiting the RV15 prototype at AirVenture in Oshkosh, and you can read more about what Dave has surmised about the RV15 on our website. If you're going to Oshkosh, it's not too early to start your planning, and that starts with the notice. It's what we used to call the NOTAM, and now you can get it at eaa.org/NOTAM. I know I just told you it was notice, but yeah, the URL is NOTAM. And you'll want to get it now because there are some 32 pages that you'll need to become very familiar with. So joining me now, Richard McSpadden from the Air Safety Institute. And Richard, what are some of the things that we really should take into account if we want to fly safely to AirVenture in Oshkosh?
Yeah, Warren, I think it's important that to realize a lot of airplanes converging on the same points, both on the arrival and at Oshkosh. And with all of our GPSs we're flying with, they're more and more accurate. So we're all coming to exactly the same piece of place and sky. So keep your eyes out on a swivel, use your ADS-B for traffic heads up, and know that arrival before you go. Study it and know it, internalize it, so you won't have time to reference it and look down. Your eyes should be outside, cross-referencing inside on ADS-B and your GPS tracking.
So, I mean, arriving at Oshkosh, we have to be pretty precise on our landing. So what can we do to get better at that before we actually have to put it on the green dot?
Yeah, good point, because when you arrive at Oshkosh, they're going to want you to put it, you know, at certain points and certain dots along the runway. And, of course, a taxiway or a runway either side depends. And being able to put your airplane down where you want it is a great skill to use there at Oshkosh. So a good thing to do in the weeks we have leading up to Oshkosh is go out and establish different points along your runway. The numbers, the fixed distance marker, the markers just beyond the fixed distance, set different places on your home runway to land and see if you can hit them.
So, Richard, what for you is fun about flying into Oshkosh?
You know, it's just an experience, isn't it? I mean, it's the biggest event in the world. There's nothing quite like it. Everybody's excited when they fly in. And so you just kind of feel this adrenaline rush, don't you, when you move over to the frequencies and you're talking to controllers. And they're so great, aren't they? I mean, they're so positive. They're giving you encouraging feedback. And just the whole experience is fantastic.
And I guess we should mention one more thing about avoiding get-there-itis.
Yeah, we saw that a couple years ago. You know, every now and then the weather rolls in, and it is summertime in Wisconsin, so thunderstorms can roll in and they'll close the field or they'll close grass parking or just different things. So being ready to be flexible to what the situation needs, and being ready that if at any point you don't like it on the arrival or inbound, just exit the arrival and get out of the traffic flow, hold, land somewhere different and collect yourself and come back in when it's a little easier is a viable option that many, many people use every year.
Great. All right, Richard. Well, we'll see you at AirVenture.
Yeah, I'll see you there, Warren.
Thanks, Richard. And since there's a chance you might encounter thunderstorms on your way to Oshkosh or someplace else, the Air Safety Institute has a resource that's worth checking out, the Thunderstorm Challenge. It's a great way to refresh your knowledge on thunderstorms and, more importantly, how to avoid them. And when you get to AirVenture, and if you're looking for an aviation job, JSFirm.com and EAA are having a week-long job fair. More than 40 companies will be pitching their opportunities. The link is in the video description. You know, lots of folks are hiring. And Congress is aware of that. In fact, Congress is concerned about being able to find enough people to fill the demand for jobs in aviation. AOPA President Mark Baker, the boss, testified Wednesday before the Aviation Subcommittee of the House Transportation Committee, and he said, yes, the demand is greater than the supply for a variety of aviation jobs.
So there is clearly an opportunity for young people to join aviation right now, and you can tell by the average wages that are going up in all sectors in aviation. The demand is high and the supply is not enough. And one of the reasons why we have our high school program is to introduce young people into aviation in 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th grade. 12,000 kids took it this last year. As we look forward to the registrations this year, we'll be in 45 states in over 500 high schools. And what I believe the objective should be, we should be in one out of every 10 high schools. We should be at 2,500 high schools with a free education program to show pathways in aviation, including controlling.
Now, the boss also told Congress about how safe and successful Basic Med has been.
It has been one of the biggest wins in general aviation in the last 50 years. You know, 70,000 people jumping into that in the last 5 years. We did the safety look back, no discernible difference between that and the third class medical at all, zero, from a safety perspective. If anything, I think it's an opportunity to revisit it and look at how can we expand it. People have been safely flying up to 5 passengers in these aircraft around the country. We are working hard to get Canada to receive Basic Med as an alternative medical crossing the border. We've got it done in Bahamas and Mexico now and most of the Caribbean. So the opportunity to take another look at it, say how this has been really a successful program to lower the cost, having pilots work with their own doctors to find out what they need to do to make sure they make the decisions every day before they fly, that they are safe to fly with that conditions or whatever they have. And I am really proud of this bipartisan event that occurred and was signed into law in 2016 and has resoundingly, for certain, improved the value of aircraft and the access to these 5,000 airports in a big way.
And turning back to getting young people into aviation, you know, Oklahoma has really run with our AOPA high school aviation STEM curriculum. The Sooner State has 57 schools using it this year. Now, that's the most in the nation. This week, the teachers who teach this curriculum are getting a professional development workshop at the University of Oklahoma. Some state leaders are there, too, and support for our curriculum comes from the very top. And that's because Oklahoma's elected leaders have been trying to find a way to broaden their economy and stabilize the fluctuations that come from the energy and agricultural sectors. And believe it or not, right now, aviation and aerospace is actually the number two industry in Oklahoma. Generates about $44 billion a year in economic impact. So the state wants to use our curriculum as a way to prop up the stability and the people going into the aviation sector and help migrate their economy away from the commodities.
This is going to help diversify Oklahoma's economy. We want to get away from a commodity-based economy here in Oklahoma, and we want aviation aerospace to lead the charge to be able to help us create an economy that will weather the next storm, whether it's oil and gas tanking, whether it's agriculture going down, or whether it's just the entire United States economy that's in a rough turn. We want aviation aerospace in Oklahoma to help us weather that storm a little bit better than we have in the past.
We'll take a deep dive into the economics of the state being affected by aviation in the video at the link above. The AOPA High School Aviation STEM curriculum is free to schools, and it is funded entirely by donations to the AOPA Foundation. And while we're talking about teaching, have you heard about AFTA? That's the AOPA Flight Training Advantage app. It's free, and what it really does is helps a flight instructor create a customized training program for each student. The Learn to Fly Flight School in Arizona has found that AFTA has made a big difference.
I'm using AFTA because I really felt like students need something to see to help them evaluate how they're progressing through their program. And as soon as I saw AFTA, I knew it was the right tool for students and I wasn't off my mark. It's been amazing.
It's a really good program. One of my favorite parts about it is before any lesson, my instructor can put maneuvers that we're going to practice, and then I could study those maneuvers. They'll have like little videos or readings for me to do that allow me to help study and practice for those maneuvers for the next lesson.
And you can read more about how AFTA is working in this flight school on our website. And we'll be back in just a moment.
Your plane is a valuable tool. With the Genesis Aerosystems S-Tech 3100 digital autopilot, you can rest assured you will arrive safely to your destination. The 3100 is the industry's most advanced autopilot for single and twin-engine aircraft, providing exceptional workload reduction, safety-enhancing capabilities such as straight and level mode and speed protection. To learn more, visit our website today.
Well, welcome back. The Reno Air Races need money. Well, that's what thisisreno.com is reporting. The Reno Air Racing Association is asking the county for some funding. Now, the costs for the air races for things like fuel and tents have gone up some 50%, and the airport can't get liability insurance for the event. They used to provide the liability insurance, so now the Racing Association has to cough up more than $1 million for that. But so far, the Reno Air Races are still scheduled for September. And Women in Aviation International has opened their scholarship program for 2023. They'll be awarding more than 100 scholarships for flight training, engineering, maintenance, and other aviation-related fields. Applicants must be a WAI member, but you don't have to be female to be a WAI member. And the link is in the description. Now, I've heard from some of you that you can't find the links I mentioned in this show. So from now on, we'll be putting links in the description, and that should make it easier to find for some of you. And now a bit of an explainer. If you're watching this on a computer, the link will usually pop up right in the upper right corner of your screen. And now you'll also be able to find it in the description below the video. But if you're watching on a phone or tablet, it's a little more complicated to get to the links. First, you need to have the latest version of the YouTube app installed. Then touch the video to bring up the player controls. And then in the upper right, you'll see three dots. Click on those dots and then click on More from AOPA Live. That will bring up the links that are embedded in the video and the description where you'll find links as well. Now, if you're watching on a browser, on a tablet or phone, I haven't found a way to display the links, but if some of you have, just let me know. And finally, an old girl has got her wings back and will be heading to Oshkosh. This DC-3 started life in 1942 as a C-47 Alpha and flew for both the U.S. and Canadian Air Forces. She then put on civvies and flew in the Yukon and Alaska for Air North under the name Yukon Sourdough. Now, she was damaged in a windstorm some years back, but she's been under active restoration for the last 2.5 years in Hagerstown, Maryland, just over the mountain from us here in Frederick. And Tuesday, she flew again. Beautiful bird. And after Oshkosh, she'll go to shows around the country and become part of the D-Day squad. Go Sourdough. Well, that's it for this week. You know the drill. Please like, subscribe, comment, and I hope to see you again next week.
And I have about 600 hours. I currently hold my commercial single engine land and sea ratings with an instrument add-on. I've been in the Air National Guard for about 9 years, so being an enlisted member, I knew that I wanted to continue a career in the Air Force, but I wanted to do it as an officer flying for the greatest force in our military. Fortunately, I was picked up to fly the F-35 for Montgomery, Alabama. So I own a Piper Cherokee 6 260, and we also have this Aztec right here, which I'm going to be doing my multi-training in. I use SiriusXM Aviation Weather because it gives me an added confidence in the kind of weather that I'm going to be flying into on long cross countries, from Florida to Utah and back multiple times up to Oshkosh back down. And so having a weather system like SiriusXM that I can rely on gives me a lot of confidence as a pilot.